After finishing in the playoffs in 1988, the Falcons fell from grace to end this season towards the bottom of the table. But a bright light was the sensational all-season form of off-guard Jerry Everett, who averaged 30.8 points per game, 9.4 rebounds per game, and was selected in the All-Star second five. However, the New Yorker won't be in the Falcons' colours next year. Speaking from Clarksville in the United States this morning, Coach Ken Cole said that Everett has been suspended from the team because of a violation of his contract. According to Cole, Everett wanted to return to his family in New York mid-tour, which was outside his tour agreement, and when questioned by management, it was felt that his excuse for wanting to break from the team wasn't warranted. The feud between Everett and the Falcons has been simmering since the end of this season, and the excitement machine has been given a ticket to New York, but not one back to Australia. Also, it now appears certain that Everett's teammate Bill Jones won't be offered a contract for next year either. Jones was on trial while in the States, and his form has been anything but pleasing. His replacement could be Bill Nelson, a 6'8" American who is trialling with the Falcons while on tour.
Alarm bells began ringing in Council's Health Department on Friday when results from a routine check of the water on Newcastle Beach found abnormally high counts of fecal coliform, a matter normally found in sewage. An investigation led them to this pipe, suddenly exposed after a sand build-up caused it to snap. In place more than 30 years, it was supposed to be discharging only stormwater runoff from around nearby Royal Newcastle Hospital. Instead, it was found to be gushing out warm water. Samples were taken and sent off to Council's laboratory for testing. The results released late this afternoon showed the water to contain levels of E. coli, the same matter found in the beach sample. A trace was made on the warm water. Its source was found to be the hospital's laundry. As to the source of the sewage, Newcastle City Council Health Department spokesman Ross Helmsworth admitted Council at this stage has no idea where it could be from. He did admit, though, that during wet weather it was not uncommon for sewage to find its way into stormwater systems. Despite having ordered the area to be roped off, roping that had subsequently washed away when we visited the area today, Mr. Helmsworth said the levels found in the water were not sufficient to stop bathing in the area. He would not comment, however, on claims the water could cause infections to anyone bathing in it. But probably even more alarming is the timing of the discovery. It was made on Friday afternoon, the very day that Australia's richest surfing carnival Surfest began here on Newcastle Beach. And with the world's top surfers to hit the water over the next few days, questions are already being raised about how safe this beach really is.
The Federation of New South Wales Police Citizens Boys Clubs was originally set up to keep kids off the streets to reduce crime and delinquency, give them something better to do, and foster good police-community relations. Since 1937, the clubs have been run the same way, but somewhere during the years, they've begun to focus more on sports and less on the drop-in centre role for teenagers, something not overlooked by government officials. Over the past 10 years, a number of reports have been made on the clubs. This latest one, the MAC report, by State Police Minister Ted Pickering. In it are 76 pages of recommendations and suggestions. But to implement them, Police Minister Pickering says he must install his own board of control, and he will seek legislative power to do that tomorrow night, an option seen as a dangerous precedent by the current chairman.
It is worrying to see government come and taking something over that is a charity and a company, and the implications are there for other charities to consider.
Minister Pickering says the police department provides 128 policemen costing $6 million a year to the clubs, but that he can't account for the money without his own board. The MAC report suggests that all police functions remain the same, but says that clubs should be run more profitably and that some of the original purposes be reintroduced, keeping kids off the streets. To show he means business, Mr. Pickering has already suspended a yearly $250,000 grant to the clubs until the interim board is formed, which is expected to be done by the end of this year. Woody Lafitte for NBN News.
Carrington staff gathered outside the shipyard before work this morning in a scheduled meeting which suddenly had a far more serious item on the agenda. The men had been on strike over delays in a national wage case hearing. However, the unions were directed by the Industrial Relations Commission to return to work before the issue would be assessed. A motion was quickly passed to that effect. Overshadowing the proceedings, the contents of envelopes which many of the men carried. Carrington Slipways last night issued dismissal notices to 124 employees and unleashed a torrent of anger.
The morale is really low, and it's been low for a long time. It's not good at all.
According to the unions, the retrenchments were no surprise, but the company was prompted to act now in retaliation for the strike.
It was indicated to us very clearly by the company that there would be no retrenchments take place. Even after the Antarctic research vessel had been finished, still there would be no retrenchments take place.
The workforce have been warned for the last several months that we were getting towards a situation where we couldn't maintain our workforce level. And it was going to come sometime around about now.
According to Keith Lynch, the company increased its workforce during the construction of the Antarctic research vessel and in the hope it would be building the Anzac frigates. The Aurora Australis is now almost completed, and although work will soon begin on the enormous A&L container ship, it won't be enough to warrant the extra hands.
We're actually getting our workforce back to the sort of level we were this time last year.
The unions challenged the company's right to hand out the retrenchment notices during the strike. Carrington's promptly withdrew the dismissals and reissued them after the men returned to work. The company says no more retrenchments are planned.
The campaign is called Pick the Tick, ticking off the National Heart Foundation's shopping list for a healthy heart. 28 types of lean beef and lamb have been okayed after laboratory tests checking levels of saturated fats.
Some people might think that red meat is actually bad for your heart.
Well, a few of our customers do believe that it is harmful to them, so we're prepared to trim it down for them as lean as possible, and it is recommended by the Heart Foundation to do so.
The Heart Foundation says the Hunter has one of the highest rates of heart disease in Australia. Figures released by Newcastle University show 390 people died of the disease here last year. That's out of a national figure of 10,000. Why do we have such a high rate of heart disease?
Well, I think it's basically our lifestyle. There are some reasons, genetic reasons, that people are born with some form of defect, but I think the vast majority of it gets back to the basics, and that is a lack of a healthy diet in many people and lack of regular exercise.
The campaign gives advice on good hearty foods, not just lean meats, but vegetables, certain cheeses, juices, oils and seafoods. While Australia still remains in the top 13 nations in the world for heart disease, Heart Foundation figures show attacks have dropped by 30% overall since 1967. Results experts relate to improved medical facilities and a healthier outlook on good diet. Peter Ryan, NBN News.
There was little doubt about the outcome of the authority's annual general meeting. Even before a vote was taken, the annual general report foreshadowed the end of the regional tourist body.
As of today, as of 11 o'clock this morning, there is no authority, no tourist authority, and the industry is without a voice, it's without muscle, it's without political clout.
The decision to liquidate follows a tough year for the Hunter Manning Tourist Authority. 4 months ago, the Tourism Commission of New South Wales withdrew its funding. Likewise, several major local councils pulled out of the organisation, opting instead to foster more localised tourism. Despite its financial predicament, the authority says it can meet all outstanding debts, with a surplus $25,000 earmarked for a last promotional brochure. Meanwhile, Chairman Bob Gee remains loyal to the authority's philosophy of regional tourism promotion. predicting the authority's demise will be felt throughout the region.
I believe it will, because whilst there is a limited representation by way of local government representation, representing the interests of the small tourist operators, in the long term, the industry will realise that to gain benefits from government, it must have a voice, it must have an organisation that represents it across the board.
Westwall's End Public's 350 students dressed in period costume for the day, reliving the era when the school first opened in 1889. It had just 58 students then, but as the mining industry grew in the area, numbers swelled to 1,000 by early this century. The old classrooms have been specially decorated for a week of celebrations. Of course, there is a cake for a birthday and a song for the school. More than 100 people watched as a teacher from 1922, Mr. Trist, told the bell to release dozens of balloons skyward, each one carrying a student's name and interests. The highlight, though, was a special treat from the RAF base at Williamtown, four Mackie trainer jets in a flypast for a century of education in Westwall's End.
Margaret and Wal Heyman came to NBN Studios this afternoon, breaking a silence they've maintained since their granddaughter's body was found in sand dunes at Stockton. Just before the murder, Mrs. Heyman decided to throw her support behind an action group of relatives of victims of violent crime. 3 days later, on November the 4th, she became one of those relatives. The group's aim was to ensure that convicted killers served their full sentence. But since then, Mrs. Heyman has come to believe that relatives can also help bring killers to justice. Her appeal for new leads in Lee's murder is proof of her determination to see the case solved.
Maybe it'll put Lee to rest, because until they charge somebody with this crime, I feel that we can't lay Lee to rest. She's, I know she's dead, but the manner of dying, I just, it's something that I want to live with us forever, but I just can't put her to rest as it stands.
Mrs. Heyman is convinced there are people in the community who've chosen not to help police.
Well, I hope the people of Stockton that are watching tonight come forward if they have any information. The police always says that somebody knows. Lee was brutally murdered, and I don't think people realise just how brutal it was. I went with her mother to see her. To think that a beautiful child had to die like she did, it was shocking. In the sand hills, all alone, I wonder what she went through before she finally died.
Last February, education officials from seven Southern African countries came to the Hunter to look at education facilities, which, back home, they can only dream of. They were here as part of Phase 2 of the Australian International Development Assistance Bureau, which will spend $7 million on an education program, spearheaded by Associate Professor Ross Telfer.
There's some evidence from the World Bank that investment in primary education in a developing country is an investment in the country's economy. So that I think we're helping the countries to help themselves. Some 1,500 people in the African countries were trained under this Australian program.
While he says that $7 million represents just the drop in the bucket, those 1,500 people trained will now in turn be able to train other teachers. But facilities leave much to be desired.
One I described to you in Malawi, where we saw 200 children outside a classroom, no room for them, under a tree. No pencils, no pens, no paper.
Ross Telfer says that however small Australia's contribution is, it doesn't go unnoticed.
Australians have got a very good image in these countries.
Dawn Gilbert, Nolene Tasoulis and Julie Clark have all lost members of their families to murderers. They came together out of a shared concern that the convicted killers who had altered their lives forever were suddenly on the verge of release. At first, they planned just to share their frustration by forming a support group with the help of Police Sergeant Paul Baker. But after a big public rally at Beresfield, they now believe they can do something to change the sentencing system.
Most of the people attending the meeting want to see longer sentences. They feel the sentences that criminals are getting are much too short, particularly for murderers. We would like to see sentences for life never to be released, but if that can't possibly happen because of the legal technicalities, at least 10 to 15 years are minimal for life sentences for very horrific crimes of premeditated cold-blooded murder.
With continued public support, the Rights for Justice Committee is asking why the average jail sentence served for murder is a mere 3 years. The committee supports the state government's Truth in Sentencing program, but it wants to ensure that judges won't just hand down shorter sentences in lieu of remissions, and they want the right to appeal against what they see as too lenient sentences.
I still don't think that 3 years is enough or 5 years is enough for someone who cold-bloodedly murders another person.
The group will hold a second public meeting on December the 4th before preparing to take their campaign to the steps of Parliament early next year.
Maitland Council is experiencing a rapidly decreasing level of both capital and working funds. Its working fund surplus stands at just over $21,000. 10 years ago, it was $700,000. Auditors consider the current surplus grossly inadequate to meet any unexpected expenditure items, a view echoed by the Mayor, Peter Blackmore.
It leaves nothing in reserve that if any sort of major event happened in Maitland, that council would be into an overdraft situation, would have to look at borrowing money to pay its debts. And at the moment, we don't have that sort of money available.
Is it a case of poor management?
No, it's mainly a case that council's inability to raise extra funds. And that comes about since the introduction of rate pegging and revenue sharing grants, that for instance, last year, the rates were pegged at 6.5%. The CPI ran at 9%, so council found itself behind the eight ball to start with.
The auditors report that the cost of council services is outstripping its revenue-raising capacity. Accordingly, council will be forced to rethink its current level of services. The indications are that fees and charges will be increased by the maximum allowable level, with Maitland ratepayers increasingly facing a situation of user pays.
Yesterday afternoon, Rita Anthony packed up her two small children and moved back home to her family. It was, she says, her only alternative to living in a house she believes was endangering their health.
I'm scratching and I'm pulling all the skin off my body. And the itch just goes, it's just all over my body.
The Anthonys took up a six-month lease on the former army barracks in Tamar Street, North Belmont, 2 months ago. Since then, Rita has been to four doctors, to hospital once, and has now been referred to a skin specialist. Not one of the medics who examined her could explain the strange skin disorder covering her body and that of her husband David and daughter Angela. One doctor at Belmont Hospital, however, thought it was serious enough to recommend she leave the house.
The doctor from the hospital is going to write me a letter saying that we can't live in this house anymore, and I've got to take that letter to the Chamber Magistrate at Belmont Court. And he can tell me whether I can move out in 14 days or not.
Her father, Arthur F. Demedes, welcomed them back to his Swansea home with open arms, saying the cramped conditions were far preferable to what his daughter had endured over the last 2 months.
Anyway. I'll tell you what, I won't put even my dogs in here, this house. This is not a house for people to live in.
Does it worry you that the children are here?
Yes.
Arthur's words were an echo of local Building Workers Union representative Bob Cochran, who inspected the home yesterday. He said it needed bulldozing and contacted the Office of Managing Agent LJ Hooker at Hamilton to voice his concern, but described the agent's stand on the matter as unsatisfactory.
They've sprayed it with a chemical once for fleas. That hasn't worked, so they'll try another chemical and spray it for lice. And I found that absolutely incredible, because the chemicals that they will be using, apart from the initial problem of whatever was causing the problem in the first place, the chemicals will probably do more damage.
However, this afternoon, Bianca Shedden of LJ Hooker at Hamilton denied they were handling the matter inefficiently. She said the office had already undertaken responsible measures to remedy the problem, adding that she was completely unaware of the Anthony's predicament until yesterday.
It was shortly after 2 a.m. when four salesmen from a Sydney confectionery company returned to their room at the Yachtsman Motel in Toronto. The four concluded a successful day with dinner at the Sulphide Workers Club, then closed the night with a few beers.
Like our manager was saying forward.
A single shot fired into the ceiling was the only warning the men had of the impending drama. The masked gunman ordered them to lie on the floor, then repeatedly demanded heroin before insisting that they empty their pockets. For reasons that still aren't clear, he suddenly fired another shot. The single .22 caliber projectile passed through 34-year-old David Eric McKenzie's shoulder, then hit 42-year-old Bruno Zand in the left side of the chest and lodged in his abdomen. Both men were taken to Wall's End District Hospital, where they recovered from their wounds. They have since returned to work, but the incident, which is being treated as an attempted murder, has left police with a mystery. Detective Sergeant Vince Fallons helped to reconstruct the case.
Well, with all police investigations, whether they are minor or serious, especially serious cases, we get tremendous assistance from the public. And with this case, we got no help from the public whatsoever.
Now, why was that?
Well, we put it down to the isolated area of this motel being at the end of the street and right on the lakefront, and we believe that's the main reason.
Police believe they may have one link with the gunman. About 4 hours later on the same morning, a man matching his description was seen stealing a gold-coloured HQ Holden sedan from a car park outside the Steggles Industry factory at Beresfield. That car is still missing. It was registered in New South Wales and carries plates GGH681. The man police are looking for is still to be treated as armed and dangerous. He was 175 centimetres tall, in his late 20s and of medium build. He had dark hair, and on the night of the shooting he was wearing a balaclava with a blue and white striped beanie. He had a blue and white jumper, blue trousers and dark sneakers. Police are now able to offer a reward of up to $1,000 for information leading to an arrest. If you don't wish to leave your name, just phone police and they will give you a secret identity number which you can quote to collect your reward. Police are waiting for calls now on 008 422 199.
22199. The alarm was raised last Friday when routine testing turned up abnormally high levels of fecal coliform, a matter normally found in sewage. Subsequent inspections revealed this broken stormwater drain, which was gushing warm water. Newcastle City Council health inspectors immediately implicated the hospital laundry. The scare prompted not only the council, but the health department and the hospital itself to run their own series of tests. This afternoon, the first of those were returned to the health department, and the results were extremely good. They showed showed the amount of coliform to be well under acceptable levels and only a fraction of the level of pollution detected at Sydney's Bondi Beach last week. The only alarming statistic that a film of sewage was found in the surface drain near the hospital in the streets above the beach. But even those favourable results don't answer the question of just where that warm water was coming from. It now seems to have miraculously disappeared, but even Royal Newcastle Hospital is unwilling to predict that's the last that might be seen of it. This afternoon, Executive Officer Stephen Batts said the hospital was still awaiting the results of further tests and would not rule out more investigations to ensure the mysterious water flow does not simply reappear.